Many know you from your TED Talk, unveiling to the public the theory of everything based on E8. So please tell us about that to set the stage for your latest research, which we're about to get into.
Yeah, that was pretty remarkable. I made some very questionable life decisions early on in what one could laughingly call a career. I was a graduate student at UC San Diego, and I was very much in love with general relativity, differential geometry, and quantum field theory. And through general relativity and differential geometry, I really got a very deep sense that our world is fundamentally geometric. But in quantum field theory, when you're first introduced to Dirac fermions, say, which are a fundamental component of our universe, it's not introduced in a geometric way. It's introduced as a column of four complex numbers. So that was very unsatisfactory to me. And I figured out there had to be a geometric description for Dirac fermions, the same way there's a geometric description for general relativity, and the same way there's a geometric description for gauge fields as fiber bundles. And when I went to people in the department to talk to them about this, nobody was interested in the problem because everybody was going crazy about the ADS-CFT correspondence and string theory. And no one was interested about some kid worried about, you know, how do you make spinners more geometric in the way general relativity is? No one was interested in the question. But I was, and I was very fortunate in that I was using a Next computer for my dissertation. I don't know if you're familiar at all with the history of Steve Jobs and Next Step. Mm-hmm. But basically, Steve Jobs got fired out of Apple and started this company called Next, where he just made an amazing computer and operating system. And then Apple, meanwhile, had a horrible operating system and it was just in desperate, horrible shape. So they brought Steve Jobs back. They basically, Next bought Apple for a negative amount of money. I think it was $400 million or something that Apple gave to Next. But Steve Jobs came back, put all his people in charge, and then the Apple's new operating system was Next Step, the Next operating system, which we now know as OS X. And this all went down, and I had been using a Next, so I knew this was going to succeed. I knew it was a great operating system, so I put all my graduate stipend and my award money and everything into Apple stock in the 90s. But Apple didn't just do well because of Steve Jobs coming back with Next. It did well because of music, the iPod, and then the iPhone, and iTunes, and the App Store, and Apple just boomed in success. So when it got time to get a postdoc, I'm like, you know, I don't need to go get a postdoc. I can move to Maui and be a surf bum, and I can work on figuring out a geometric understanding of spinner fields, and I can just do the research I want. So that's what I did. And it was a very strange decision because I essentially left academia still, even though I still have a very academic mindset. But the one question in my mind was, what are spinners and fermions geometrically? Why do they exist? Why would nature have them as part of our universe? And I struggled with that. I tried all different approaches. There's this cult of geometric algebra. I don't know if you've encountered it.
Now, why do you call it a cult?
I call it a cult because it's a cult. It has, you take the CL13 Clifford algebra and you ascribe that can be used for space-time to great effect. And physicists use that for, you know, that's how Dirac formulated the Dirac equation, is using this special CL13 Clifford algebra and its representation in terms of Clifford matrices.
Uh-huh.
And it turns out Clifford algebra is really useful for doing rotations, or if you're in space-time, you're doing space-time boosts as well as rotations, you're doing Lorentz transformations using Clifford bivectors. But you can go over the top and formulate everything you would normally formulate with differential forms and vectors. You can do that by translating that into Clifford algebra. And there's this guy, a very wonderful gentleman I had the honor of meeting, David Hesnes,
right,
who dedicated himself, I think, in the 1960s to developing this way of describing a vast amount of fundamental physics using Clifford algebra. And he got a following, and there were some other, a lot of people became part of it and also wrote books on it and really good papers. And so there became this whole volume of literature for how to describe fundamental physics using Clifford algebra, which they called space-time algebra, including this very unusual formulation of Dirac fermions. And since I was interested in what Dirac fermions are geometrically, it was natural to look at this literature on geometric algebra. It turns out I drank the Kool-Aid for a while, but then I'm like, you know, some things with differential forms you can't do with Clifford algebra.
Such as?
Like the way integration works. When you're integrating over differential forms, that's essentially what they're for, right? Differential forms are things you integrate over and then use the, Stokes' theorem to do the integral. And then there are things you can do with vectors and forms. Like, so when you, a differential form is a dual space to vectors, right? So you can do it either way. Either you can say a differential form eats a vector and gives you a scalar, or you can say a vector operates on a differential form.
Yes.
Via the interior product to give you a scalar. And those are equivalent. But if you're doing something like the geometry of fiber bundles, or say the geometry of a principal fiber bundle, okay, then you have a Lie group as your fiber over a base space. And if you want to describe how that Lie group is twisting over your base space, you do that with what's called a connection.
All right.
And the most natural way to describe a principal bundle connection is as a Lie algebra valued one form, right? And there's no Clifford algebra to be seen unless your principal bundle is a spin bundle, in which case you have, you know, spin 1, 3, and then Clifford algebra. So in order to build the spin algebras, those are the same as Clifford bivector algebras. Are you aware of this?
Yes.
Okay, so this is how you get representation spaces of the spin group. Is you go to a Clifford algebra, you build the Clifford algebra corresponding to the spin algebra, and then the bivectors of that Clifford algebra are your spin algebra generators, and the matrix representation you're using for the Clifford algebra is the matrix representation then of your spin algebra.
As far as I know, David Hastings would say that Michael Atiyah and Roger Penrose, when they talk about the mystery of the spinners, that's like saying the mystery of rotations and dilations, because they see the spinner as a rotor.
Yes, that's right.
So you see this as an impoverished view or a view that is assuming other structure?
I see it. So the cult of geometric algebra presumes that they can describe all of physics with this framework, and that by not really looking at differential forms or vectors, but incorporating that into Clifford algebra, into geometric algebra language, they can still do everything. But really, you lose capability when you do that. So, for example, if you want to, the connection for a spin bundle is a Clifford bivector algebra valued one form, and that's called the spin connection. And that's a very natural thing for mapping from, you know, Lie algebra. So basically you feed it a vector, which is whichever way you're traveling, and then that transforms to how the fiber is rotating, right? So, and this is how you do parallel transport. It's how you do, Wilson lines and those integrals. So really you need Clifford algebra and you need differential geometry. You can't just wrap up differential geometry in Clifford language and glue it together and still have the same powerful framework. There's stuff you can't do as well, and there's stuff you can't think about as well. So at that point, I left the church of geometric algebra, and I embraced geometric algebra just as it's CL1-3. It's a Clifford algebra, and you use it the way you would any other Clifford algebra.
So before we leave that cult, if there are some people who are David Hastings fans, and I think there is Lassenby and someone else as well who are the current...
Brilliant people. They do great work within that context. And I have a lot of respect for them.
Give a problem or a question that can't be solved or even formulated in the real geometric algebraic formulation, but it can in the differential one.
Durham cohomology. Doesn't make a lot of sense using Clifford algebra for curved spaces, but it makes perfect sense for differential forms and arbitrary manifolds.
Well, you just gave a concept, but I mean, give a physical situation or a physical problem that differential geometry is well posed to solve, but it doesn't even make sense in the geometric algebraic case. Or it can't be posed in it.
Say you're doing general relativity and you're doing unusual cosmological topologies, and you start doing integrals to determine topological invariance of these things to figure out what that is. That doesn't work well in Clifford algebra. In fact, if I recall correctly, Lazenby has a theory of general relativity that is based on flat Minkowski spacetime with fields being on top of that spacetime using Clifford algebra language, using geometric algebra. And it works to a degree until you start to think of things that actually depend on unusual spacetime topologies and embedded topologies.
So non-trivial topologies can't be described in geometric algebra, or a specific type of non-trivial topology?
I'd say non-trivial topologies generally, the tools aren't as powerful there. So geometric algebra is the best, it's absolutely the best at describing rotations. And that's why it's so useful for describing the spin group. Okay, because the spin group's all about space-time rotations.
Apparently computer graphics artists use it as well because of this reason.
Yeah, that's what it's absolutely great at is rotations.
You may use it on your website, which we're going to get to later, because there are plenty of rotations involved.
Yeah, that's several layers between the code and the...
Okay, so you're taking us currently through your journey where you are enamored by the differential geometric aspect of spinners, trying to find that connection. How do you geometrize spinners or understand them in a geometric manner? You first approached your colleagues, which happened to be string theorists, which is quite odd to me that they wouldn't know, because in my experience, the most educated people in differential geometry and bundle theory currently in the physics scene are the string theorists.
Absolutely true. But they would say that fermions are anti-commuting excitations of a heterotic string.
So that's too algebraic for you.
Well, there's a lot of structure to get there. So you have to swallow that particles are fundamentally oscillating strings, and when you do that, you know, if you associate a particle with each oscillation of a string, you get an infinite tower of particles. Of higher and higher, larger and larger masses, an infinite number of. But we don't see an infinite number of different kinds of particles, right? So you don't see the tower of states. And then string theory gets more and more complicated the more and more you get into it. And okay, string theorists promised that they'd get the standard model by finding the right compact Calabi-Yau manifold, right? And then the standard model would just fit that and everything would be good and we'd have this wrapped up before lunch and have a good theory. That was 40 years ago or something, and it never happened. It seems like with the string theory is an amazing framework for constructing anything, but it doesn't give you a theory of everything. It gives you a theory of anything you want. And I did not buy into that elaborate structure. I took a course in introductory course in strings as a graduate student from a brilliant guy who started out in general relativity, Malcolm Perry, I think, gave a great string theory course. But there were so many jumps between the standard model, which is very well established, to strings, to all the framework that comes along with strings. You actually made a fantastic exposition about 2.5 hours long called The Iceberg of String Theory recently.
What Garrett is referring to is the Mathematics of String Theory, the Iceberg Edition, where I go into details about the math of string theory. It's on screen now, and it's linked in the description. Don't forget to follow Theories of Everything with Curt Jaimungal on Spotify for exclusive content and in-depth discussions. Your support on Spotify helps us grow and to reach more curious minds like yours. Check out the link in the description and join the Core Toe community on Spotify today. See you there.